So I'm a big believer in ergonomics at work. I'm a professional code monkey. I type on the buttons all day long. You gotta be set up properly to avoid a sore back and sore shoulders and
oh God, my back!
But a properly set up workstation, well, that can make all the difference in the world. At work, we just got new monitor setups, but the new monitors, they're a little bit too low, and I wanna build a couple of monitor stands, but 1¾ inches tall, not much, just enough to raise them up to a more reasonable height to protect my neck. I went out to the fancy wood store, got myself a slab of walnut, and the first step, of course, is to cut everything to length. I wanted to make 2 monitor stands out of the single slab of walnut that I purchased, so I cut 2 pieces out of the slab with my skill saw. Now I want the grain on these stands to be continuous, as in I want it to start at the bottom of one leg, come up, go across the top, and go down the other leg. So I made sure that when I was cutting my material to length, I accounted for the length of the leg. Now cutting the legs to establish continuous grain is a little bit tricksy. You gotta hold all of the pieces in your head and understand the geometry and just really think through your cuts. But it's worth doing because the subtle detail of having the grain run continuously all the way across the piece really makes it pop. So at one point along the way, I cut the 45 degree angle on the top of one of the legs and I had to make a straight cut to establish the bottom of the leg and therefore the height of the leg. The piece ended up binding in the blade because I had a very thin piece between the blade and the fence and a very long piece that creates a lot of leverage on the opposite side of the blade. Caused a little jump, a little bit of a scare, no big deal, but I did end up cracking the leg in half. That combined with the fact that I was trying to establish continuous grain meant that I couldn't really start again without having to start again on the entire piece. I put super glue on both sides of the crack, shoved them together, clamped them, and hoped for the best. Assembly was pretty straightforward. I'm using a new technique that I picked up lately whereby I use a combination of wood glue and super glue with kicker. The really nice thing here is that you don't need clamps. You slather wood glue on one of the pieces and you put a couple of dots of super glue, then you put a little bit of super glue kicker on the other piece and you hold them together for just a moment until the super glue kicks. This makes clamping something slippery like a 45 degree miter really, really simple. Definitely recommend you check it out. Okay. Let's do some math. I've got the initial glue up done and now I have to decide on the location of some splines to strengthen that big long miter joint. The depth of my monitor stands ended up being 9 7/16. I was trying for 9.5, but you know, shit happens. And I'm gonna use 3/8 inch wide splines. The reason for this is just that I've got a blade that'll cut a 3/8 inch wide dado, so that's really easy. So I wanna use 3 splines because everything about this project is a rule of threes, so I think that'll look kinda cool. And so if I add up the width of all of my splines, I get 9/8 of an inch. 9 7/16 less 9/8 gives me 8 5/16, which works out to 133/16 of an inch. That ridiculous number is the depth of the monitor stand less the depth of each of the 3 splines. There's 3 splines, we want 4 spaces in between splines, we divide that number by 4, and that's gonna give us the space in between each spline. If we do all those things, the splines will end up in exactly the right spot. And you thought you wouldn't use the math that you learned in grade school. So, in order to make this cut, I've got a bit of an elaborate jig going on here. These 2 pieces of plywood, they are 90 degrees from one another, but they're 45 degrees off from the bed of the saw. I've also got a stop block glued in here so that the side of the blade is exactly 2.078 inches, I think that was what it was, away from this stop block so that I'll get the splines correctly inset from all 4 corners. Okay, so here's the thing. I was gonna put 3 splines along the length of each side of the miter joint, but I think it looks better with just 2. I'm gonna keep it with 1 and 2, and I actually really like the ratio that I've created here. By anticipating that the third one ought to be there but leaving it out, I think it looks really cool. All right, now that the tenons, I guess, rabbits, I don't know, now that the spot for the splines are cut, I gotta actually cut the splines themselves. I had a couple of scraps of hard maple kicking around, so I cut some small squares out of it that fit nicely into the slots that I had cut. The splines themselves were just slathered with wood glue and press fit into the slots. The fit was tight enough that I didn't need to clamp them at all, and once the glue set up, they were nice and secure. Now, apart from just being visual, the purpose of the splines here is to actually add strength to that miter joint. The thing about it is that you've basically got 2 surfaces that are stuck together with their end grain, and gluing along end grain isn't actually very strong. You're best off to add strength by including some splines. Now, if you're gonna include some splines, why not make them out of a contrasting wood and add a little bit of visual appeal? It's an easy way to elevate a simple project up from mundane to something that's actually quite visually pleasing. Now initially, I only applied one coat of a semi-gloss polyurethane to these pieces. I figured they weren't gonna get touched a lot. They're kind of tucked away underneath my monitor, so I didn't think I needed to build up a number of coats of protection. But after they sat at work for a couple of weeks, I noticed something odd. It seemed like the grain had raised and like the smoothness of the finish had failed. So I ended up bringing them home, sanding them down, and putting on another two or three coats, this time of a gloss polyurethane, to add that nice smooth surface back to the pieces and also to bring out the gloss level of the finish. The downside of adding all that polyurethane is that that product tends to yellow out wood or add sort of an orangey tint to the wood, so that nice hard maple splines that I put in that look almost white when they're naked, they kind of turn a little bit orangey on me. In the future, I might have to look into a finish that adds the same protection level as polyurethane, but doesn't add so much color to the wood stock. So that's it, four coats of finish later, and I was ready to take these things into the office. They look great sitting underneath my monitors, and they really bring a touch of warmth to my desk, which is otherwise littered with technology. So it's a really nice thing to add to my desk that kind of gives people a taste of what I can do outside of the workplace, which is, it's a nice little conversation piece. Anyway, that's it for this project. This is dead simple. If you want to make something like this, by all means, please give it a shot. You don't have to go fancy, or you can go fancier yet. You can use your choice of materials. This is a great thing that you can do to add a little bit of personality to your space at your place of work. If you want to keep an eye on what I'm doing in the future, please hit that like and subscribe button below. And of course, if you want to keep up with me between projects, you can follow me on social media. I am at ApprenticeMarks on both Twitter and Instagram. Cheers, I'm out.